Welcome to the Purpose Nation Podcast, inspiring conversations with Christians in science, technology, and industries of the future. For more information or to make a tax-deductible contribution, visit PurposeNation.org.
This is Brad Cooper with Purpose Nation, and today we have a great interview lined up for you where I'll be speaking with the CEO of a very fast-growing software technology company called SailPoint, Mark McClain. Mark, welcome to the Purpose Nation podcast. How are things in Austin today?
Just great, Brad. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to join you on the podcast. Looking forward to our conversation.
Likewise. You're based out of Austin, not too far, I imagine, from some of the effects of Hurricane Harvey. Obviously, our thoughts and prayers are with many of the Texans who lost loved ones who've been impacted by Hurricane Harvey. Any impact for maybe people in your company, relatives? What's been any of the impact that you've seen? Now, you're far enough away, I'm guessing, to not be in the brunt of it, but what's some of the things that you've been seeing there?
I think in general, for folks that don't know, we're a couple hundred miles, roughly a little less from Houston. Between Austin and Houston, there was bands of heavier rain, right? Austin itself got a pretty heavy rain weekend last weekend, literally nothing that even gave us a real scare. Honestly, the only long-term impact here, and that's been gas shortages, believe it or not. There's been issues getting gas. There have been, so to speak, runs on the gas station circa 1973, you know, gas crisis. Nothing terrible. I think everybody assumes they'll work through that quickly. I'd say in general, for most of us, it's hard not to know people in Houston. When you live in Austin, it's like living in LA and not knowing people in San Diego, right? It's been pretty tough. The number of people who've been displaced, sadly, there was a little more loss of life, I think, than maybe folks hoped there would be initially after the hurricane initially hit. The issue has been homes and shelters and getting people out of their houses. And they're estimating something like 50 to 70% larger impact here than Katrina, which was just a huge, literally, I've heard on the order of $150 billion of property damage is one report I've heard. So it's going to be a tremendously impactful thing for the Houston area for a long time. Lots of, you know, rebuilding and people having to get new homes and all that. It's been cool. There's been a lot of outpouring of both people wanting to marshal up gifts. You know, you see great things happening with those of tremendous wealth. Even Michael Dell here in town committed to a big number I saw today. And a lot of people are putting forth a lot of money to try to help. And then obviously some set of folks have had the ability to get over there and help physically, everything from get waterlogged things out of homes to help people find places to live, etc. It's a pretty significant event, obviously a time for to folks to come alongside their fellow community members and do what they can to help. But it's certainly been a higher impact thing than maybe everybody had hoped it would be.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Well, definitely. And our thoughts or prayers are with, especially people of Houston, but the whole state of Texas. And like you said, it's great to see so many people responding and just prayers and thoughts with the people of Houston and of your state. Looking forward to discussing how God has been working in your career and life. So just a real quick background on Mark. He's been in the technology industry, leading it for over 20 years, developing, leading some very successful technology companies. He's been the founder and CEO of SailPoint for the last 12 years. And SailPoint is a fast-growing leader in the software technology with something called identity management. And I'd like to hear more about what that means, kind of a fancy term. But we'll have Mark break that down for us a little bit. But he and his company have been recognized for having just a great company culture, not only the success of the company, but awards from some of the Austin business newspapers and sites around their employee ratings of both Mark as a CEO and then just the company. And he also just has a track record even before that of building and growing really groundbreaking technology companies. In 2000, he founded a company called Waveset Technologies, and that experienced a lot of growth, ultimately leading to an acquisition by Sun Microsystems. Also had a career with Hewlett Packard and IBM in the Bay Area in both Austins, and then recently kind of more of a serial entrepreneur. And on top of all of this, Mark's obviously just a great Christian and has been active in sharing his faith and leadership strategies with other Christian leaders and CEOs through groups like the C12 group. So starting off, what is SailPoint all about? What does your company do? What are some of the problems it solves?
Sure, glad to. Yeah, I think the term identity management is sometimes people in the consumer mindset go to identity fraud, right? The things we all love to talk about today of credit card issues and identity theft. That is not the part of the identity landscape we play in. We're in the enterprise identity management. And in that context, it really means ensuring that the right people have access to the right things within the corporation or the organization. For anybody that's ever worked for any size organization, but particularly a large one, in today's world, you have accounts and passwords to systems that have important data in them. Business applications like SAP, for people to know that, or Oracle, Workday, and Salesforce. For people to do what they do in the average company today, they have, in some cases, a few and in some cases, a very large number of what's called access privileges. So I'm Brad. I work in the accounting group. I need access to these 12 systems to do my job, and I have these kinds of privileges within those systems to either view data, change data, etc. What SailPoint does is to help bring all of that information together, because in typical organizations, that information is spread out across numbers of different systems and different data storage places. It's not all kept centrally. Well, we bring it together centrally so we can get a 360 degree view of who you are, what role you play in the organization, what things should you have access to do your job. It kind of a no more, no less is the thought. It's called least privilege, right? You should have kind of the minimum things you need to do your job, and ideally nothing more, right? But over time, what happens in every large organization in the world is that gets badly managed. You move around, you change jobs, you transfer, the organization brings in new systems, and people just keep collecting lots of access rights or privileges, we call them, but then they don't get taken away. And over time, quite commonly, people have access to things they really shouldn't. And in today's world of data breaches and bad hacker things happening, there's more and more concern that as good stewards of the data and information in their enterprises, people need to know exactly who has access to what, and is it correctly configured or correctly set up. Mm-hmm. And our products help span all those kinds of systems in the enterprise, bring it together, give that central view, keep things on track, meaning over time, these things tend to atrophy and go badly. How do we bring them back to Brad does this job, he should have these things and only these things. And now there are audits that companies do to verify this is correct. They have to prove to their management teams that their employees are correctly set up. And we do that for the largest organizations in the world. So our customers are generally what are called Fortune 1000, large organizations, the banks and the insurance companies and the retail companies that you all see on TV and the internet and cable, right? It's the biggest brands out there.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, just from my own standpoint, I'm at a smaller company now, but I've been in bigger companies too. But man, like hundreds of passwords sometimes, it seems like.
Exactly.
And I think consumers just in general can sort of, at least, even if it's not, your product is not geared towards them, can realize just how many passwords that they have for so many different systems. And especially with a lot of these things going into the cloud now, where it's not necessarily software that's sitting on your computer, but now you've got all these passwords to all these different sort of disparate things. And yeah, if you move around in the company, and I think there was one example I heard of, it might've been an interview that you did where there was somebody in a bank, maybe in Europe, maybe it was a guy who went like from the IT department to like the trading floor or something. And somehow
because he
had access to like the IT stuff, he covered his tracks. Is that right? I mean, is that like an example of what your software would prevent?
That's actually one of the more famous egregious examples in our industry of a guy who moved from one job to another legitimately, started doing things that were at first just a little too risky, and then later on downright illegal. But because he still had IT privileges, information technology privileges, he wasn't supposed to, he could cover his tracks. He could literally steal other people's passwords and appear to do trades as someone else. I mean, it was a classic case of poor identity and access management, not keeping track of who had access to what, enabled this guy to do a lot of very bad things. And ultimately, it came to light, and it literally had cost the bank something like $7 billion in lost trades.
Wow.
Huge.
Got it. And so your company, just a couple of stats, maybe, I don't know what you can, it's a private company, yes, and I don't know if you disclose revenues or employee size, but just some sense of sort of the size of the company and how you're growing.
We're at a point where we're kind of cautious about what we share externally as a private company. We did publish some information last year. Our revenues in fiscal year 2016, which was calendar year for us, we got over $130 million in revenue, so we're a pretty good sized organization. And I think at that time we published that we had, I think, just under 700 employees. And we've continued to grow very well, both on the revenue and the employee and the customer side. It's just those are the things today we aren't talking about quite as
Got
broadly.
Got it. Okay. Successful company growing. That's fantastic. So now I'm going to take a big shift, rewinding and going back into the life of Mark. Tell us about growing up, where you grew up, maybe a little bit about family environment, and then also what are some of the things maybe that might have led you into thinking about business or thinking about technology, and then also if you could touch on the faith background.
Okay, yeah. I was very blessed, fortunate to grow up in a home with two very strong Christian parents, good family upbringing, parents who love each other, stayed married, all that good stuff. Very fortunate there. Grew up in a suburb of LA, kind of lower middle class, as I like to say. We didn't ever want for food, but I didn't have a lot of new stuff. You know, that kind of a childhood. And so grew up kind of not really aware of the business world much. Mom was a teacher, dad was a social worker. So kind of grew up kind of understanding the social service professions and helping professions and things like that. Got interested in some business things after going to college. I was an economics major, thinking I might do business, might do law. That was sort of my thinking when I went through the undergraduate world. Grew up oldest of four boys, very close-knit. I was the oldest of four boys in 6 years, so it was a rambunctious but fun-loving house. Yes. I'd like to say my mom was one of those moms who was happy about that. I can see some moms might not have been happy about having four boys bouncing around the house, but she really enjoyed that. And you know, my parents really had a lot of fun with it. And my brothers and I are all still close. We had a great time growing up. One of the things we talked about, you know, was kind of the, did you have your own lemonade stand? It's funny you mentioned that. I've actually said to people, I was not that kid, right? I was the kid going on my way to play baseball with my friends, laughing at the kid sitting out with his lemonade stand.
Going, no entrepreneur background or no. Wanting to start a business or anything like that. You're just enjoying life.
Exactly. I was the opposite. I'm like, why don't we just go play baseball and get mom to give us some lemonade, right? Why would I do that? A dad in the social service welfare department of the county, and my mom teaching, right? All basically government employees, not a lot of exposure to the whole world of business. Just kind of did well in school, enjoyed academics, and therefore kind of gravitated to being challenged and try to be quote unquote a success as I grew up, and just kind of gravitated toward, well, business sounds like it has some interesting challenges. As I got a little older and learned a little more about it, managed to find myself starting a career at IBM, which was not at all where I was headed when I was in college. Just kind of series of circumstances, I landed a job there, and next thing you know, I was in the world of technology and really enjoying it. That well planned?
No, it didn't sound like it. If you were thinking about a career back then, was there like a second path? So if it wasn't landing at IBM, was there some other career, either as a kid or even later in college, that you sort of had your sights on?
You know, it's a great question. I tried to put my brain all the way back there. I mean, interestingly enough, I mentioned this briefly. I majored in economics because somewhere along the way I had heard that sort of let you go toward either law or business. And I was like, well, both of those sound kind of interesting. And it is sort of the old defer the decision challenge right here. I was like, well, why don't I just do economics as an undergrad? Then I can make that decision later. I'll either go to law school or business school, right? And, you know, I think the path then was I ended up applying to law school and getting waitlisted, which is a perfectly bad way to clarify the decision, right? I'm like, well, I could get in, I might get in, I might not. And so in the meantime, kind of did some job searching and ultimately didn't get into law school. And so as a result, I thought, okay, well, I'll just go work for a while. Maybe I'll go back to school later, either law or business. And kind of, again, through friend of a friend, I was looking at various kinds of bigger corporation type business opportunities and just found a way into IBM. And again, had done a little bit of comp sci. This is, I'm in college in the early 80s. So computer science was becoming a bit more of a thing, but it wasn't the thing it is today.
Right.
Programming was not as big a thing yet. I did enough programming to know I shouldn't be a programmer, right? I went, I can kind of understand this stuff. My brain is more wired for people and business and strategy than it is for technical things. And so I kind of figured out I liked technology. I just didn't want to program for a living. So right. I knew that much by the time I got to college.
Right. What other, is there another talent maybe that you had either growing up or now that people wouldn't expect from a technology CEO? Playing the guitar, maybe sports? What was sort of is there a special talent that you might have that maybe people wouldn't expect?
I'm a little bit of the master, what is that saying? Jack of all trades, master of none, trying to remember the phrase there.
Right.
In that sense, I was pretty good at a lot of stuff and not excellent at anything. I mean, I had very strong academics, I had good grades, but I was a good athlete, but not great, kind of a good high school. Maybe I could have played at my small college probably, but I was no Division I/pro athlete. I was musically inclined. My mom was musically inclined. So I played some instruments, played the guitar. But again, not ever the caliber of a professional musician.
Right.
So I enjoyed a lot of things. And if there's a talent there that I think God gave me, it's sort of that ability to relate to a lot of different kind of people in a lot of different types of environments. I'm comfortable around really technical people. I'm comfortable around really artistic people. I'm comfortable around really nerdy business types, whatever. I kind of can relate to a lot of different people, and in a general management/CEO job, that is a very useful skill, right?
Yeah.
To understand the different ways people think and how they look at the world. I always joke, Microsoft simplified the world for us a number of years ago, right? Word, PowerPoint, and Excel, right? Are you a words person, a pictures person, or a numbers person?
That's a good analogy. Right? Yeah, exactly. Well, yeah.
Right? And I kind of, again, like a little of all those things, and I'm probably a little more oriented toward pictures and words, but you know, I have a decent facility with numbers, but I'm not as good at anybody at any one of those things. I'm just kind of broadly capable in a lot of them.
Right. You're the office suite.
Yes, I'm the office suite. There you go. Perfect.
All right. All right. Good analogy. And again, as you said, you know, it's also good for somebody who manages all those different types of skill sets. So out of college, went to IBM and I guess HP in the Bay Area is a little bit of a culture shock, or what was that like?
So I've been 7 years working for IBM in LA, and I was in the field, field, what we call the sales engineer, systems engineer, which is basically the technical, you know, engineer in my title was always funny to me. It's the technical part of the selling organization, right? So I was not an engineer. Mm-hmm. Then I switched over to become an actual rep, which we called a marketing rep back at IBM, but the sales rep. Kind of decided I didn't like the whole living on a quota, living in the sales force forever. That's when I got my MBA at UCLA and kind of leveraged that to go into marketing at more of the product program kind of marketing, that kind of marketing. And I did that at HP. So I moved to the Valley from LA to work at HP. And so my Valley experience, which by the way was whatever, 92 to 95, right? So my Valley experience was not kind of the crazy startup part of the Valley. I was working for a big corporation, right? At HP. I did pick up on some things about the Valley, but honestly, it was later in my career where I either was at a startup and or working with companies that were in the kind of the thick of the Valley, I would call it, where I really got a more of a sense of the Valley mindset. I think when I worked at HP, I could have been working almost anywhere in some ways. It was just a big corporate setting. You know, HP, as you probably know, Brad, has historically, this is less true than it was 20 years ago, they seeded a lot of the Valley. It was a very entrepreneurial, innovative culture. So a lot of people, if you trace their roots, that started pretty interesting tech companies, a lot of them actually made a sojourn through HP. So it was a good place to kind of, more so than IBM, it was a good place to kind of develop some I learned some great things at IBM. I learned kind of some really good discipline and planning and structured way of approaching things. IBM was a machine, right? And HP was more a collection of innovation and entrepreneurs. So it was really interesting kind of two different backgrounds to blend. But it was out of those that I kind of ended up going into my first kind of startup world. Well, when I left HP, I actually came to a company I wasn't a founder of called Tivoli, later bought by IBM. So it was just going public, but in a day when people went public much smaller. So it had a couple hundred people, I think about 200 people when I joined. You know, here the smallest company I'd worked for was HP with 90,000, right? I mean, it's a pretty big culture shock to go to a 200 person company, but it was fun, right? It was energetic and lots of flexibility and, as I now call it, lots of white space, right? Kind of go figure it out. You know, not a lot of predetermined, go execute something someone else thought of. You got to go figure it out. Mm-hmm. So it was very invigorating. And then we got bought by IBM literally the first year we were public right after I got there. So kind of went back into IBM through that acquisition, but not really is sort of the way I describe it. Because IBM, to its credit, kind of let Tivoli run as an independent company. And so I still got to watch kind of a fast-moving entrepreneurial company grow through those years. Kind of this is 95 to 2000, roughly. It was interesting. It was both some really good and some not-so-good lessons of things to do when you're growing really fast. Kind of market adoption was crazy, and we couldn't even keep up with demand. It was quite a ride. But I learned some good and bad things that I thought about. And then, to your point, I went off with some buddies in 2000. And actually co-founded a company called Waveset. That was the name of the first one I actually founded.
And was that in Austin? When did you move to Austin?
Yeah, so I moved to Austin for Tivoli in 95. So IBM bought it in 96. So that 4 years of with IBM at Tivoli was all in Austin. So my early career was IBM in LA, out in the field, kind of classic traditional IBM. My second stint, so to speak, at IBM was after Tivoli got bought, and I was in a very different kind of a role as basically a marketing leader who ultimately I became the VP of marketing. I ran the marketing group there for Tivoli, and it was just a very different experience than my first time at IBM. Right, I was in this entrepreneurial part of IBM. We were growing really fast, doing a lot of crazy things, trying to change the way IBM thought, honestly, about how to be aggressive and entrepreneurial. But eventually, it just became very challenging to do that inside the IBM machine, and culture. And so that's when I decided with some buddies to go to launch out on our own.
So you were you the business guy then of WaveSet, or how did it break down in terms of like your buddies and the co-founders that started that company?
Good question. It really was kind of a two and two. So my buddy Mike was the CEO. I was the president. We were kind of two in a box, really, but you know, you had to split the titles. And Mike was a very business-minded engineer, and I was a reasonably technically-minded business guy, so we were a good match. Then our other two co-founders, one was a VP of marketing, Kevin, who ended up becoming my co-founder at this company. The other was a VP of engineering. So we sort of had two guys that came more from the product engineering development side and two that came more from kind of the marketing, product marketing and management side. And then ultimately, as the company started to grow, we had to add in, you know, sales and finance and operations kind of people to round out the management team. But the core was kind of a product development, product management kind of core.
Got it. Okay. And that company, pretty fast success, it seemed like, and was bought by Sun when it was in 2003, so about 3 years?
Yeah, it was 3.5 years. It's funny. We literally got bought right, if you know the world of startups, and I'm sure you do, but general policy is still you start people with a 4-year stock option thing and invest in 4 years. We literally got sold in month 35. I'm sorry, month 47, right? Literally right before, the month before we would have fully vested. It was hilarious. You know, it was a fast run. As I look back at it now, that was 00 to 03. And so you know the market, right? Right. The tech bubble, the first tech bubble kind of blew up in late 99, early 2000. And so we had just started this company. All of a sudden, everybody was crashing and burning that were startup tech companies because most of them were internet bubble, right? Eyeballs. Right. I'm just going to get a bunch of people to my website and I'll figure out how to make money later. And all of a sudden, people went, I'm not sure that's a good business plan. And all those companies started imploding. And we weren't that kind of company, but because we were just a new tech startup, we spent a lot of time explaining to people we weren't that kind of company, right? Mm-hmm. No, we're building enterprise software. We're helping big companies do stuff in the back office. It's nothing like internet consumer, right? So once we kind of got through that initial choppy waters of the first couple of years, we got through that, started to really get some nice momentum. And then it turned out there was a handful of startups in that space and a bunch of the big tech companies, Sun, Oracle, IBM, others decided they sort of wanted to play in that market. And all the startup community basically got acquired. So our startup competitors all got acquired by our other big company competitors. We got acquired by Sun, who, as many folks know, is now part of Oracle. But back then, Oracle, Sun, IBM, Novell, HP, all these tech big titan players went off and bought all these startups and entered the market that way.
And that was, it seems like a pretty successful sale. And then how long was it between that? And you said, yeah, you know what, that was a pretty crazy experience. Let me do that again.
Yes, you were inside my head, Brad. Those are the questions. No, I think what we did, we stayed about a year, year and a half. We had kind of a, you know, kind of a reason to stay, as they say at Sun. They kind of locked us up with new financial incentives to stay. So we stayed and we tried to help make that business successful inside Sun. And it really was. But ultimately, you know, as often is true, when you're an entrepreneur at that point, I'd shifted into an entrepreneurial mindset. You find yourself back in a big company after acquisition. And you go, you know, this isn't really what I signed up for, right? I don't want to be the head of a division inside a big company. I want to run another company. So a year and a half, we stayed at Sun, took a little bit of break, and then two of the four co-founders, Kevin and I, and then we added a third co-founder who we'd known and worked with quite a bit in our past, Jackie. The three of us started this company, SailPoint, in basically the very end of 05. So about a year and a half after we had left Sun.
Okay.
Excuse me, about a half a year after Sun. Yeah.
Okay. And so obviously you've been there for 12 years, successful as a CEO. It sounds like a lot of your customers are on the technology side. You've obviously dealt with your co-founders and executives at your companies and programmers. So good exposure to both the technical and the business side. What are some of the things that you would say are good skills for a leader in a technology company to have?
Oh, good question. I'm a big fan, Brad, of this concept. The book is called Strengths Finders, but it's kind of a concept that's getting a fair amount of traction out there. This idea that kind of figure out what you're good at, and instead of spending a bunch of your energy trying to fix and shore up your weaknesses, kind of focus and develop even more what you're good at, and then complement yourself with people who are good at the things you're not, or surround yourself with folks like that. And I'm a big adherent to that thought process. So what I would say is there's a lot of different kinds of people who can successfully lead companies in general and technology companies in particular. I think the secret is being both self-aware enough and to be blunt, humble enough to admit what you're not good at and to ensure that you have people who are good at those things so that ultimately your team is well-balanced. As we were saying earlier, I have some good strengths around kind of people skills and people people, culture. I have some good skills around strategy, and my background was kind of sales and marketing. So I've got good understanding of markets and market dynamics and sales and value propositions and all that. My background is not as strong, even though I've worked around them, in true product development and engineering and hardcore, you know, great financial management. So the skills to be a CFO, the skills to be a VP of engineering or a CTO, the skills to be even a great sales leader. I have to ensure that I have people on my team who are excellent at those things, and the overall team is stronger as a result. So it's very much, in my mind, a team sport. In that sense, more like football than basketball. I played basketball, but my son's a football player, and I think the thing I learned is, you know, basketball's become even more over time kind of a swappable thing, right? People move all over the court. The guy who's out front shooting can get underneath and rebound. But in football, you know, linemen and quarterbacks don't swap. There's a specialization there that says for the nature of that game, you need people who are very good at what they do. And I think of business more like that, right? Mm-hmm. You need people, you do need some generalization when you're young, right? There's a lot of wearing many hats and trying to figure it out early on with a small team. But as you get any amount of traction at all and start to grow, you really do have to think in terms of, have I got all the right skill players in the right position? Kind of the old Jim Collins, you know, right people in the right seats on the bus. I'm a big believer in that way of thinking.
Mm-hmm. Well, and so for people listening, so they hear the trends in technology and how big of a player these big companies are, you know, the Apples and the Googles and the Amazons and Facebook, yeah, and how much power they have and how much they're growing and the influence. And, you know, everybody thinks now, oh gosh, my kids have to be programmers now, even though they don't want to be, you know. But I mean, you yourself, and as well, I'm sure others in your companies are a good example of, you can still make an impact and be part of these trends and technology, but not necessarily want to love to be a programmer.
Absolutely. Yeah, a couple of different thoughts in there, right? As you say, even though we have these giants of industry now, whatever the stat is, right? Three of the most valuable companies in the world are technology companies, or four or five or whatever the number is. Yeah, it's hard to ignore the presence and the impact those giant titans of industry have on our industry and, frankly, all industries, right? Look at that. In our backyard, Amazon just bought Whole Foods, right? I mean, mm-hmm. Who knows? Facebook and Google are both effectively getting into the car business, it sounds like, and mm-hmm. Apple. I mean, just like industry lines are getting blurrier and blurrier, right? But by the same token, it's still a very big world, right? So there's a lot of places to go get into the world of technology that over time, maybe some of those guys will get into, but they don't do nearly everything that's needed in the world, those giant companies.
Right.
And to your point, there's a lot of places for people to be in technology companies who are not programmers, to be in the legal side of it, the sales side of it, the marketing side of it, the accounting and financial side of it. There's a lot of great places to be in technology companies without being a technology expert. I think in general, my sense is, especially in what I call the customer facing, meaning if you're selling, if you're marketing, things like that, if you're not a deep technologist who's an engineer building technology, it's generally helpful to have what I just call technical aptitude, to understand how things work and why this concept and that concept are related or not related, right? I think if you really struggle with that, maybe the technology industry is not the best, but that's a pretty wide swath, right?
Yeah.
It's, you know, a lot of people could get their brains around technical concepts, even though they may not want to sit down and write code all day, right?
Right. And what's sort of your guess? I mean, this is just top level, but, you know, like percentage of people, employees that you have in the company that are in the more technical programming development teams versus, like you said, in the other departments, administrative and sales and accounting, if you had to break it down.
Question. Yeah, I guess, you know, every tech company is a little different. We're a kind of company where the technology is also fairly complex, and therefore we have a lot of what we call support and services people that either help
right.
customers, you know, deal with issues or help them implement the product in the first place, right? If I add up all of those kind of as the more technically oriented jobs, and even as we said in the field, there's the technical arm of the sales force, as opposed to, you know, our sales reps are generally not programmers,
sure.
but they have some technical competence.
Sure.
But if I think of the truly technical crowd, that's probably, I don't know, 2/3, 3/4 of our employees at least.
Yeah, you have to have technical competency to be in sales and talking to IT managers about your product. But those folks aren't hands-on, like, programming your product.
No, if you go that way, Brad, I'd say, you know, matter of fact, these are some industry stats. And a lot of technology companies, the actual portion of the company that is developers is on the order of 20 to 30%.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Like, out of a 1,000-person company, a couple to 300 might be true software developers, engineering,
right. okay.
all kind of people.
Yeah, okay. And that's sort of what I was thinking. Because, I mean, you know, most people out there, they think of these technology software companies, and everybody everybody's just sitting there behind a computer programming stuff. But to what you just said, I mean, actually 2/3 or more are actually not. They're actually out there in the field working with customers that, yes, they have the competency to understand it, but they're not hands-on, you know, programming your software.
Let me jump on your point and ride it a little bit. So here in Austin, right, we're kind of generally viewed as kind of a low second tier or high third tier tech city, right? If the mm-hmm. Valley is sort of the only top tier in the world, arguably, and then Seattle and New York, LA, and there's some other very large tech centers now, right? Partly because those are just big cities with a lot of tech companies. Austin's maybe, you know, third tier, low second tier, whatever, right? Mm-hmm. Well, Apple and Oracle and Facebook and Google all have very large footprints here now, right? Apple and Oracle, in fact, will have their second largest concentration anywhere in Austin, meaning mm-hmm. at second to the Valley, second largest concentration of people will be here. Almost none of those jobs are programming jobs, right? They are customer service, support, marketing, a whole lot of stuff that doesn't necessarily require computer science. So to your point, these giant tech companies hire tons and tons, thousands and thousands of people who are not programmers.
Yep. Okay. Now, talking about the company a little bit and the company culture, and then also kind of going into your faith and your influence on that culture, your company has won some awards. Yeah. And what are the couple of things you would say that have made your company have such a great culture?
I think one of the things, Brad, I always start with on this is it's intentional. I think one of the things that's sadly true in my experience, especially in technology companies, but in generally a lot of companies, every company has a culture. A lot of them accidentally evolve into one as opposed to intentionally develop one. Certain things start to be the norm, and pretty soon that is your culture. But it's shocking to me how little thought goes into a lot of those things. And I think we've had a bit of a focus on culture now, maybe for 10 or 15 years. But I think even that's been a little misguided at times, because a lot of times people mean by culture fun, right? So people think culture equals, if you're a startup, free drinks in the fridge and casual Friday and free tacos or pizza on Wednesday, right? That stuff is not culture. It's a part of culture. Culture in the sense that it kind of says, hey, we like to have a fun environment. I always say to people, look, culture is about how you treat people and how you do business. Culture is the way we do things around here, which has to do with values, right? You pointed out our values are on our website. They're pretty visible. Integrity, big value here. Innovation, big value. Impact and individuals. Those are our 4I values. You know, that's the way we think about running the business. So it affects who we hire and who we keep. It affects who gets promoted and asked to do more. It affects the kind of partners we work with. It affects the way we expect our people to treat and interact with our customers. That's culture. My super simple shorthand to our culture, and you'll recognize it's a bit of a twist on a Bible verse, is treat people like adults, right? Kind of golden rule is treat people like you want to be treated, or treat others as you would have them treat you. And I say in a company, what a lot of people want, whether they're people of faith or not, is they want to be treated like an adult. Well, what does that mean? It means give me enough guidance and direction so I know what success looks like so I can do it, but don't micromanage me to death. Don't tell me exactly what to do and how to do it, because competent, capable people hate that. They don't want to be micromanaged and told what to do all day, but they also don't want to be left so wide open they don't even know what success looks like. What I stress to our leaders and our managers is, hey, treat people like adults. Give them clarity and guidance as to what you want them to do, then let them use their gifts, talents, and abilities and experience to do it. That's generally what makes people very happy workers, right? If they think they have interesting things to work on and a lot of freedom to how to do that, that's satisfying work for most people.
And it sounds like you also, in terms of hiring, have, I can't remember what the three were, but one of the things that you look for in people, I think it was like competency and humility was one of them. And
yes,
that's also, it sounded like that's sort of a hard thing to find. And I know just hiring people in from a technology company too, you've got your stars and then you've got, you know, people who are real nice, but they're not as good. But, you know, so, I mean, that sounds like one of the things that you use as a guiding principle as well.
And to be fair, I'm always quick to give credit. I stole that set of concepts, at least those three word concepts, from Patrick Lencioni, who's actually a Christian author who writes some really great books about culture and companies. But yeah, his words are hungry, humble, and smart, right? Mm. You want, the book's called Ideal Team Player is the name of the book. And it's like, look, you want people who are hungry, right? People who are ambitious, want to get better, want to learn, want to stretch themselves. You want humble, and that's humble as in not stuck on themselves. I always tell people the greatest quote I've ever heard, I think it's attributed to C.S. Lewis, I hope that's right, is that humility isn't thinking less of yourself than you should, it's thinking of yourself less. Mm-hmm. It's not that you have to be falsely humble in the sense of, oh, I'm really not good. We work with a lot of really talented, capable people. They are good, right? But they're just not prima donnas. They're not stuck on, I'm the center of the universe and everybody has to get out of my way or kowtow to me. That's the kind of people we don't want here. We don't want the people that, while they're incredibly capable, are very difficult or damaging to their teammates. And as you said a second ago, but unfortunately, we also don't want really, really nice people who aren't very good at what they do, right? Because this is a job, right? You have to deliver real results and we need you to carry your part of the load. It is that balance of very capable people, but people who you enjoy being around because they're not jerks. And then his last third item is smart, and that's just simply both IQ and EQ, like intelligent, but also emotionally intelligent, right? Know how to work with people, give and take, share the glory, share the disappointment, share the responsibility, right? Just team players who get that. If I'm going to succeed in a company, I've got to understand myself and my teammates and make sure I'm contributing to the whole, right? So it's just, those are the big concepts we focus on. And in general, I think this culture stuff is not hard to understand. It's hard to do. It's not that the concepts are that difficult. It's that people just don't do them. They start to let the jerk who's really talented stay, and then other people get ticked off about that guy being around and they leave. Or things get off kilter, and so people start the micromanaging thing, right? I'm going to grab the wheel and tell you exactly what I want you to do because I'm nervous that we're about to have a problem here. Well, again, that drives good people away, right?
Mm-hmm. As I was hearing you talk about your business and what you do, and then here you're talking about how you create such an amazing, you know, culture of integrity and team players and people you can count on, it almost seems ironic that your software is sort of built to prevent the things that are becoming more prevalent with bad insiders, you know, doing bad things. It's like if you had some good people on your company, maybe there'd be less need from your software. But I know a lot of it's more complicated than that. There's a lot of, you know, people have phishing attempts and all kinds of things and don't have anything to do with people being bad people inside the company.
That's
but
right.
Anyway, but yeah, it's a sort of, and I've seen it in Silicon Valley too. I mean, yeah, you definitely can. I mean, just anybody can just look at sort of the stories that they've heard about Steve Jobs or any of these other kind of high flying CEOs even, you know, in terms of their personalities and kind of not really the most humble of leaders or people, right? not setting the best example.
Yeah, because to your point, there are very successful people who don't meet those criteria. But I also say, look, success is often not measured only by money. Many of those people have, quote, successful careers as defined by wealth, income, et cetera, not necessarily successful lives as defined by healthy relationships, you know, healthy marriages, healthy adult-child relationships. I unfortunately know lots and lots of very wealthy, successful people at this point in my life who don't have the kind of lives they wish they had, I'm pretty sure, right? Their marriages or their children haven't gone the way they would have liked, and it's because they were so busy chasing success, they missed some of those other things.
Well, that's right? A great lead into what I was just going to ask next, which is, what are some of those challenges? You know, you obviously could spend 15 hours a day in the office, and you probably travel a lot, and I'm sure there's a lot of challenges being the CEO of a fast-growing technology company. How do you balance those things between family and work and integrity issues and, you know, so being a Christian in a pretty fast-paced and sometimes challenging environment?
There is no simple, easy answer. I actually gave a talk on this recently at church with my buddy who's our senior pastor, and we said that in some ways, a life is a series of temporary healthy imbalances. You have times when work is very demanding, and you have times when someone is sick, a child or a spouse or yourself, and there's an imbalance where you have to get your health right, or there's an imbalance where, you know, when you have a brand new baby, if you're going to be a good parent, you're going to spend extra time at home, or you have a teenager who's going through issues. So there is, in some sense, a overall imbalance at various points in our life. And I think that the secret is, over time, are you striving toward balance? Meaning, I'm trying to be a good parent. I'm trying to be a good husband. I'm trying to be a good leader at work. I'm trying to stay healthy. I'm trying to make sure I'm serving, both maybe in a church context or in a community context. It's just being conscious of those portions or those wedges of our pie shape of our life, right? Mm-hmm. If your life is a bunch of pie wedges, are you consciously thinking about how am I doing in all of those things? And if I'm not where I should be, what do I have to do to kind of reset toward getting that right? Sometimes you can only do so much to reset. If you're going, we joke about the accountant in April, right? His life looks very imbalanced in April. But if it looked that way all year, you'd say, ooh, that's a problem. But it's okay if it's temporary for a good reason. There's kind of a sense of, are you looking at your life as a big picture over time and striving to achieve the right balance of what you think you should do with your life, how God made you, the things he's telling you to do? That is all we can strive for.
Right. And so with technology companies, and we talked about some of the big ones, you know, Elon Musk, and you see all these people out there, and not many that you can sort of point to, You're one of the rare ones that I've been able to find, and Pat Gelsinger, who you know I've talked to as well. Not as many out there, you know, out there in the front forefront, at least, that we know about with their faith and their Christian faith. Any idea? Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts about that? I mean, is it that there are fewer people in these companies, fewer that are willing to come forward with their faith? And what are some of thoughts on why that is?
I think you hit the two highest ones, right? I think there's not a lot of folks who consider their faith such an important part of their life, unfortunately. And I think that's true in a lot of the world, but particularly in leadership and particularly in the technology industry. And then I think for those that are in that mindset, it's, you know, sometimes it's challenging to decide how much you want to be out there. I'm not oriented to be an evangelist. I'm very clear about that. I don't think my job is to use my bully pulpit or something to pound people with the gospel. I think my job is to live, you know, the salt and light passage. I want to live in such a way that I'm treating people in a way that is comparable to what my faith says I should do, and that they appreciate that, but they don't ever feel like I'm trying to convert them or I'm trying to force them into something at work that they don't appreciate. Because I develop relationships with people, sometimes I get to have those kind of conversations, but it's based on a trust and a relationship at that point. It's not just because I'm going to use my authority or my position to do that.
Right. So, you know, I've been at some of those big companies, and some of them actually had prayer groups or Bible study groups, you know, even at Apple when I was there, you know, they had Bible study groups. So I don't know if you have that at your company, if anybody has started those, but for people who are other companies too, there's some, like you were saying, you know, you want to be out there in front and evangelizing, but still also there's this feeling like you have to compartmentalize, is kind of the word you hear often of you're in church on Sunday and not the rest of the week. I mean, what are some of the things maybe yourself personally that you've done to just make sure that you're kind of keeping your faith and your God and whether it's prayer or maybe reading scripture, either for you personally or maybe some things you've seen at your company or other companies for people to make sure that faith is still more integrated and not completely separated between Sunday and the rest of the week?
Yeah, no, I think it's both. You know, for me personally, it's me taking time in the mornings generally, but as best I can throughout the day to kind of pause and stop and think and reflect and either read or pray or things like that. I think for the company, it's kind of creating that environment. We have some Bible studies, we have some prayer times, we provide those. We don't thrust them on anyone. We make them available. We have a program called Marketplace Chaplains, where there are people who are available to counsel with people. Again, not necessarily about religious topics, right? Could be about a struggle with their marriage, a struggle with a aging parent, a struggle with a difficult teenager, that can just talk to people and say, how can I help you talk through that? So I think we try to provide a lot of opportunities and avenues for that, while never making it feel as if it's expected or required to be a SailPoint employee, right? These things are available to you. We care about you as a whole person. We want you to succeed, not just at work, but in life. And to the extent we can help you with that, great. We're not trying to replace a psychologist or a pastor or whatever in your life, but we're trying to treat you as the whole person you are and do what we can to make you a better person while you're with us, right? Mm-hmm. That's kind of how I look at it. It's that flourishing. You ever heard that term, right? How do we help people flourish, whatever stage of life they're in?
Absolutely. That's great. Yeah. And so for people who are out there listening, maybe young people entering college or maybe going to be graduating this year and entering the workforce, what are some things you would recommend for them to do, let's say, to prepare themselves for a job at your company, at SailPoint or some other high-tech company? What are some things that they should be sure to do to prepare themselves for a career in a high-tech company?
I think being self-aware, you know, talking to friends, family, counselors, whatever that you think, you know, guidance counselor, career counselors that help you figure out, are these your aptitudes? Are these your skills? Do you enjoy these things? And then if they're interested, like you said, you know, that doesn't necessarily mean they have to go become a programmer. They may go into finance or marketing or sales or other functions, but enjoy doing that in the context of a tech company. And then I think it's just sort of being available and flexible. How do you open yourself up to opportunities? Again, more and more, all companies are becoming somewhat tech at some level, right? We talk about digitally enabling businesses now, right? A food company, a retail company, a manufacturing company, all of them have large technology capabilities. And I think it's how do you handle that people have to wrestle with.
And as far as Austin goes, you know, as a city, as you said, it's a pretty tech, you know, enabled city at this point. A lot of big companies are moving there. There's other centers around the country. But I mean, do you have to be in a big city? Or I mean, you probably have some satellite offices too. And what's sort of your thoughts on the trends as far as locations of technology companies and people who think that they might want to join these industries? What are some thoughts on that?
Austin is a great place to be because there is so much tech activity here. And we mentioned some of those others, you know, Seattle and Denver and the Valley, obviously, and LA and New York and Atlanta. And, you know, there's a lot of places where there's a lot of tech things happening now. I think as a young person, it's sort of figuring out what part of the functional world you want to live in. Are you, again, a programmer, a marketer, a salesperson, a finance person? And I always tell people that's the content. I always say, think content and context. What's the content you want to work on? What kind of stuff? And then what context? Do you want to do it in a 5-person company or a 50,000 person company? Very different, right? If you want to be a salesperson, selling large enterprise software, SaaS solutions is very different than selling used cars. You're still selling, but it's an incredibly different job. I think it's that, where do you like to spend your time and energy? What kinds of functional things? And then what context do you want to do those things?
Mark, so I have Christian parents who tell me, you know, I'm concerned about, you know, what my kids might experience. If I do send them off, they become programmers, or maybe they're just getting in the business side of a technology company in either Silicon Valley or Austin, other places. You know, the perception they have is sort of this high tech is sort of the land of atheists, materialists, kind of high driving, fast driving type people with different worldviews potentially than we have as Christians. And with your experience in high tech, what would you say to them maybe to address some of those concerns?
Good question, Brad. I think my frame of this whole issue even goes back to folks that kind of wrestle with where to put their kids in school, right? Homeschool, Christian school, public school. And I think a lot of this is just trying to be thoughtful about your situation, certainly, you know, listening to God and getting good gut counsel from friends and others. But my general answer to these kinds of questions is the whole salt and light issue, right? I think we're not necessarily called to run away from the darkness. We're called to invade the darkness. And I think in some degree, yeah, tech can be a kind of an area that's challenging at times based on some of the mindsets and attitudes there. Science and tech, probably science in some ways as much or more than tech. But I look at theater and the arts, I look at various fields. It's, you know, there's a lot of secularism in education today. I'm not sure there's a lot of places where people go where they won't feel like their fundamental worldview is under some level of attack or certainly disagreement. And so I think it's if this is your gifting, right? If you're gifted in tech or science, or even as a business thinker, finance, marketing, sales thinker are attracted to tech, then I think you should follow that and just know that there will be challenges there. But honestly, I'm not sure they're dramatically worse than other fields in today's culture. So my view is, you know, wade in there. And if that's where you're called to be, I think you're going to feel the confirmation of that pretty clearly. And if you're not, then don't. But I think that's what we do. I think we try to figure out where God's calling us to be and do what we're called to do. And if we've missed those signs somehow, then we usually get clarity pretty quickly, like, oh, this doesn't seem like it's working the right way. Maybe I misread that. So I'm not certainly a fan of, gosh, you need to go where it's safer and more comfortable. I don't think that's our calling as believers, to go where it's safe and comfortable.
Right. And was that an issue at all for you personally? Or did you ever run into maybe some ethics issues, you know, in the various, you know, things that you've done, whether with vendors or partners or employees, you know, worked with? Or wasn't it so much a factor? And like you said, you know, not any different than any other type of business or environment?
Exactly. Yeah, Brad, my point would be, yeah, we've had in the companies I've worked in and in the companies I've had the privilege to lead, there have always been some number of issues to manage. I think in our companies, the last two that we've led, you know, I think less than some, because we had a very strong set of values. We were very clear and vocal about those values. So there was a bit of self-selection. You know, a certain set of people who might not have shared those values as much just didn't choose to be here. And conversely, the people who did share those values, whether they were Christians or not, I think would find themselves more comfortable in that setting of, you know, kind of a high integrity kind of setting. But we've certainly not been without issues because of that. And so, yeah, every so often you got to manage through ethical, legal, HR, whatever kind of challenges. And I think, you know, we do that with grace and do our best to stay true to our worldview and our values, but it certainly doesn't absolve us of those challenges.
For you personally, Mark, how has God sort of worked you through those challenges, but also just decisions in your career? You know, whether you went off to law or business, as you said, mm-hmm. or were there some key either decisions or turning points for you where you saw God at work in your own life?
Truthfully, Brad, I say this a lot. I'm much better at seeing it in the rearview mirror than out the windshield. It's certainly easier to look back and say, oh, I kind of see how those things work together for good, to quote a passage. I feel like there were times when I bumped into a wall in parts of my career or felt like things weren't going as well, and that caused me to take a different path. And now I look back and say that was maybe some level of frustration or even, quote, trial, but it led to making decisions or choices that led to places that were very good. So I think sometimes we either get confirmation of things or we get the opposite, right? We sort of see that things aren't working or are not gelling as much as we might like, and that's sometimes a sign to take a different path or do something different. So I feel like I've tried to be sensitive and open to both the counsel of Scripture, the counsel of fellow believers, and just even, you know, trying to listen to God in my head, which, again, I'm not a big audible voice of God person, but I think I have felt guided or prompted in certain directions at times. And I think as I look back, some of those things led to very clear directions that I felt were the right place for me to be. But then I can tell you again, as I sit here where I am today looking out the windshield, I'm not completely clear on the next few steps now, right? It's very hard to know exactly where the path is leading in the future. And therefore, I'm trying to be careful to not get ahead of myself or God on those kind of things. Just take a step at a time and keep walking step by step.
And along those lines, what's next for you? What should we pray for you and for your company? What's sort of coming up in the next year or so here?
Oh, just, you know, the company continues to grow. It's got a lot of great potential. You know, we see it having the potential to continue on its own. We're privately held today. That could continue for a while. We have the opportunity, we think, at some point to consider public offering. We have the opportunity to consider M&A kind of opportunities where some larger tech company might decide we're a good fit. So we see multiple healthy opportunities in front of us. And I've always kind of told the team, don't get too hung up on what the ownership, ultimately these are different ownerships of the company, right? Are we owned by venture capitalists or private equity folks or public investors or private investors? At the end of the day, those things have less impact day to day on most people's lives than they want to believe. Most days, you know, you're a marketer, you're an engineer, you're a salesperson, you get up and do your job. And I feel like that's our job, is to build great products, take care of customers, compete effectively in the market, and let the ownership issues take care of themselves over time. I don't have a set plan for where the company needs to be by some certain date. I think we just continue to do the right things with customers and products and markets, and a lot of that stuff will just take care of itself. Mm-hmm. So I try to hold that view and encourage all of my teammates to hold that view as well.
Well, that's great. Well, Mark, thank you so much for your time today. You've been so very gracious with your time, and we've learned a lot, and just wish the best and blessings. Pray for you and your company, your family. Thanks so much for your time with us today.
Thanks, Brad. I appreciate it. Yeah, I think, you know, if you're inclined to pray, I always tell people, pray for wisdom and clarity. Those are my two favorites. Right? Like, I like to make wise decisions. I'd like to have as much clarity as possible, but sometimes we aren't given clarity and we have to forge ahead in some level of fog. I'm okay with that too, but I think just trying to make the best decisions we can with the limited visibility we have is all we can do here. So that's what I'm trying to do, but I appreciate it.
Thank you. And I'm also going to, just based on this conversation and trying to get my stuff set up for this interview today, I'm also going to go back and look through all my passwords and my identity management, I think, today. I have too many things going on my computer. So that alone, you know, is going to help me for today. So thank you for that.
There you go. That's right. Let's keep you from getting hacked. It'll be a good outcome.
All right, Mark. Thank you so much again for your time.
Yeah, it was a pleasure, Brad. Good luck. And thanks for taking the effort to put this together. I hope it's helpful.
Thank you for joining the Purpose Nation podcast. For more great interviews, resources, or to make your tax-deductible contribution to support our nonprofit ministry, please visit PurposeNation.org. This program is copyright Purpose Nation, Inc., a 501c3 nonprofit corporation.